Peace be upon us all. Good afternoon. I'm sorry, can I speak English well? Honorable the leadership Nanyang Technological University, Honorable Mr. Ong Keng Yong, as Rajaratnam School of International Studies, Mr. Minister that I respect, Mr. Ambassador of Indonesia, and ladies and gentlemen, Islam, not only theological Islam, is not carrying the teaching of theology and ritual, but also Islam bring civilization, mission, culture, as well as humanity. After 13 years, the Prophet of Nabi Muhammad, 13 years in Mecca city, he failed to build the civilization in Mecca. Then he hijra or move to Yathrib city, 485 kilometers in the north of Mecca. The city was called Yathrib because it was built by someone by the name of Yathrib bin Laut bin Amit bin Sam bin Nuh. So he was the great-great-grandson of Noah, the prophet. So that's why the city was called by Yathrib. The prophet came to the city and he find that he was in the pluralistic society. He found that the one Muhajirin, or the migrant group from different tribes. The second one, they have like indigenous tribe from the Yathrib local, Yathrib. There were two tribes, Aus and Hafiz. And there were also non-Muslims, there were Jews, and three other ethnics or tribes, the tribe Quraizo, and the tribe of Nadir. The Kainuka tribe were mostly, there were guilder, or they were in the business of gold trading, while the Quraiza was the peasant, and when the Madinadir were the workers. There was some pagan religious there. The prophet came to the city that he found that he was, the people of Yathrib was very plural, and he decided, so this is the Arabic language, in the name of God, the merciful, the Arabic verse, the migrant Muslim, the local Muslim, and the Jews of non-Muslim, as long as you have one nation, one goals, all of them actually are one people, one community. That means the Prophet of Muhammad 15 centuries ago, he was successfully built a community, an ummah, who without any constitution, a religion, and not without, and without any ethnical constitution, not Arabic country, not Islamic country. That's why we called the Medina civilized. The principle of that mu'atana, or citizenship, tanawu, pluralism, and takamul, or integrity. These are the Prophet Muhammad's principles when he was in the Medina city. And he was successful. He was successful, and one time there was a Muslim who killed a Jew in a market. The Prophet was very angry, and he said, whoever killed a non-Muslim, it means that he will also have to face me, or my enemy, and whoever is my enemy, his life will not be survived. There was also a story where there was a thief, a female thief, Usama bin Zaid, as the commander of security, what they call it, Satpol PP, or the community police, and he reported that there was the female thief who was actually the daughter of the a very best friend of him. His father, her father is Usman bin Affan. So what happened? Shall we release her just to keep the good family name? And the Prophet was very angry. Wallahu ya Muhammad. If the thief that you capture is even my own daughter, bring her here. I will cut her hand myself. Hopefully this will also be practiced, heard by all the Indonesian police or the Singapore police too. The Prophet kept saying that every Jum'ah prayer, very Friday prayer, on the last message, this means there should not be any conflict except for those who violate the law or violate the constitution, violate the law. These are the our enemies. There should not be any conflicts because of we have different religion. Because if he's Christian, he's our enemy. It's just because we have a different ethnics or different of political views. There's only one conflict that's allowed is because of they violate the regulation, violate the law. The terrorists are our common enemy. The criminals, the drug dealers, drugs, these are our common enemies. The drug dealer, the gambling, these are also our enemy. As far as we are, they are good, even though they are in coming from different religion, Buddha, Muslim, these are our true mission of Islam. So Prophet Muhammad never said anything about Islamic state. He never said about Arabic state. He said Arabic Madinah, Madaniya, Mutamaddin, Madani, Tamadun, which means civility. So these are Arabic words. After 8 years, the Prophet entered the returned back to the Makkah on the Ramadan month in 8th Hijriah, or the lunar month. The Prophet with 10,000 of Islamic followers entered the Makkah. The people of Makkah were afraid because they were scared that Muhammad will revenge, because in the past they have hurt the Muslim people. And the Prophet Muhammad said, not today. Today is the blessing day, the day where we forgive each other, the day we will strengthen our brotherhood. No revenge. I will forgive all of you, the people of Mecca. I will forgive you all. And some of them even screamed in Krima, the son of Abu Jahal, he also forgave him. With this giving, forgiving him, there were no, come on Islam. No, there not even one word, let's go. Come on Islam. I will say, he only said, I will forgive you, those who have hurt me. So all the people of Mecca have embraced Islam just because the Prophet have forgiven them. Even though he said, even though that if you are, so if because you are good, because you are polite, these people will go embrace Islam voluntarily. You see them embrace Islam. This is the history of Muhammad Prophet. Now Islam is now in the Archipelago Nation, the Nusantara, the Indonesia, and it was brought by the Sufi, not by the warriors, or not those who bring weapons, weapons to kill, but those who came to bring the Islam religion is by bringing ahlakul kalima, a good moral, bringing morality, good ethics, not just bringing a gun or bomb who came to the Nusantara or to in Archipelago. Nusantara, the Archipelago, Islamic of Archipelago, are the range of islands, Nusa Antara, the land from Thailand and Singapore, Malaysia, Singapore, these are the lines of islands, Nusa Antara, between islands, among inter-islands. So in the past we had this oath of Palapa, the Gajah Mata, the ruler of in Hayamuruk in the Majapahit kingdom, he fought to unite the entire archipelago, and this was also the base or become the inspiration of what we had the Oath of Youth in 1928. Islam who came to Indonesia is Islam with a good moral, not bringing some weapons. If I may provide you into my Indonesian, the people of Hindu in the past, they were not allowed to read the their holy book. There were four castes in Hindu, and the holy book were only allowed to be read by Brahma or Satriya caste, and the lower level. But when Islam came, all Islam Muslim people should be able to read Quran. At least they could be able to read Al-Fatiha, the initial verse of Islam. So all people, all level of the society are allowed to read the Holy Quran, not on a certain level. The Sunan Kudus, one of a very popular scholars in Central Java, Sunan Kudus, he asked the people not to sacrifice the cow, because in Arab there were no goats, or there were no Sunan Kudus, the Hindu king at that time, there was his name was Panchawati, he found that asked the people not to sacrifice the cow, so that he found that Islam is equal with them. So that was his strategy, how he started to spread the Islam in. So the king of Brawijaya the fifth, he had a lot of 600 wives at that time. So the king may have a lot of wives or concubines, but maybe now you are not allowed to have one. So one of his wives was a Muslim. Her name was Subah Chi, from the Chinese. They had a son. Her name was Jin Bun. This kid was very naughty. He escaped from the palace and went to a Surabaya city. And he came to this area, what we call Ampel Denta, and there was this big, very Muslim scholar, Sheikh Rahmatullah, or we call Sunan Ampel, the son Ibrahim Samarkand, came from Persia, Samarkand, and also one of them, few of the Prophet Nabis, and he came to this very long story in Tuban, in East Java. To cut the story short, I can speak for 2 years. If I don't make it short, Jin Bun then embraced Islam, and then he changed his name into Abdul Fattah. And after he studied Islam for 3 years, and he spoke with one of his teacher, I would like to establish an Islamic climate. I will become a king, Islamic Islam, and." The Sunan Ampel said that I will not involve in politics. Just let the young do that, because if I involve in politics, people will always fool me. Mr. Minister, politics is in Arabic, fa waw lam yaf kaf in Arabic letter, politics. But if the Arabic people Arab is not politics, fa walaytuka, because. I will lie to you, because it's different. That's the politics. So if you add the Arabic word, is said by the Arabic people. So it's mean the contrary. So not long after that, the first Islamic kingdom was then established in Demak, Indonesia. The king was Abdul Fattah. That was the Jin Bun, the son of the fifth Brawijaya of the Majapahit kingdom. After he found out that his son is become one of the Islamic kingdom, then at that time maybe he communicated through WhatsApp or maybe SMS at that time, okay. So he spoke to one of his other son in Raja Kukang in Palembang in Sumatra. Kukang is in Chinese. Kukang is an old harbor and now in Palembang city at the present day, Al Jazeera. My son, do you know your brother Jinbo is now become an Islamic king? Please think about it. And then he replied it through WhatsApp, and then he replied it, Father, apologize. I'm also a Muslim myself. I changed my name Fatahillah. And before it, his name was Abdali Hadila. His father got confused because all of his sons are now converted to Islam. And then the people of Japatahit also converted to Islam because the people of the Mak, we called Santri, is with the highest moral, with the higher good deed, and then keep that from the never they never hurt any other people. They will respect their parents, they love their parents. That this is Santri, is that's this is Santri in the past. Santri modern day may be a bit different, but if you all become the people of the Mak, the people will be called as Santri or the good people, we can say. If you are not the people, become the people of the Mak, you are not the good people. Then the people of Majapahit, most of them came or then joined or converted to the Mak kingdom. The Brawijaya the fifth then had to convert to Islam. With the confession of the king of Brawijaya Islam, then the story of the big emperor, the Majapahit, who had his best day or heyday during the Gajah Mada era. And that's it. It's finished without any war, without any bullet, without any bomb, without any. So only by 50 years, from 1950 up to 1500. These are the efforts of the ninth wali, or the nine scholars, Sunan Gudus, Sunan Bonang, Sunan Ampel. So there are nine scholars, Islamic scholars. In Cirebon, we have Sunan Gunung Jati. Cheng Ho came to Java 7 times, and it was recorded in his secretary, Ma Huan, Zheng Ho, the general, the admiral of China. He built the Semarang, he built this city, and his men were the Confucians. He came in a visit one day to a Cirebon city. There was this, and among the N4, there were a beautiful daughter, an Ong Tim, and then the king of Sunan of Cirebon asked her to marry, and then the Islamic teaching and then started in the Chinese community after the Sunan Gunung Jati married a Chinese descendant. And if you go to the palace, there was this small door where you use this. They usually do the praying there. So when we go back again back to the past, the N4 of the Chinese kingdom, they made an audience to the Singhasari kingdom. His ear was cut. This N4 was a Muslim, a Chinese. And then 1 year after that, the Chinese troops will go back, wants to take a revenge and to fight the Kertanegara kingdom. So all of this army, the three generals were Muslim. ZP, Kosi, and Ikamisu were all Muslims. So when they arrived in Singhasari, or present-day Surabaya, Singhasari was no longer there. It has been divided by Doho Kediri Kingdom. And then they met a young man called Raden Wijaya. If you want to take a revenge, Singhasari is no longer gone, it's gone. Let's go take a revenge, then let's fight the Doho Kediri, and then Doho was defeated, and then the Majapahit Kingdom was then established. So the first king of Majapahit was Raden Wijaya. By the help of the Chinese troops, then the Majapahit kingdom was. So without China, there will be no Majapahit. Without Majapahit, there will be no Nusantara, the oath of Palapa. Without Sumpah Palapa, there will be no oath of the youth. Without oath of the youth, without there will be no Indonesian united. So without without Chinese, there will be no Indonesia. So only the good Chinese, not only the conglomerate, not a very bad conglomerate. Then there will be there are conflicts. So some of these Chinese were then expelled to Bangka Belitung and the East Kalimantan. So that's why you will find a lot of Chinese descendants communities in this area. So the conclusion is the Wali Songo or the nine scholars have successfully converted the archipelago into Islam without any war, without any violence. Just by showing a good deed, good moral, the cultural approach, moral approach, building civilization, asking all the community, all the people to jointly to agilateran to build equal living and equal in the rights and responsibility. These are the visions of the ninth scholars. In 1914, Kyai Haji Asin Asyari just returned from Mecca. He had a very big agenda in 1914. There were no Indonesian. Indonesia was not established at that time, and it was not even born. Hasim Asyari had a vision to unite Islam and nationalism. Islam only, without nationalism, will not be able to unite the people. Nationalism without Islam, the liberal nationalism or secular nationalism without any values, or will not have no values without Islam. Why? Because Kyai Haji Asim Asyari really understood the condition in the Middle East. This is the I'm talking about Middle East now. In 1924, the Ottoman Empire was now on shaking, or the Ottoman Empire was occupied by Morocco, Tunis, Syria, France by the French, Egypt, Sudan, Iraq by occupied by British, Libya by Italian. So the Empire of Ottoman was helpless. That we call the segment of Europe. People are dying. That's the Ottoman Empire at that time, because they were actually dying. Within the Turk, there was this one man, what we call someone who is he was a traitor. His name was Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, who also destroyed the empire from inside. When the empire was then destroyed in 1924, the last empire 1924, Abdul Mahid was then exiled to Germany. These scholars Muslim then gathered in Al Azhar University in Egypt. They negotiated or deliberate to build this, to build the Khilaf or empire back, and then there came with no success to agree something. They failed to agree on deciding what is the criteria to become the empire and then Khalifa, and who will officiate them as the Khalifa or empire. And then if we have the empire, emperor, where is the capital of the empire? They also failed to agree on that, and then they agreed to disagree. This is Islam is failed. So the movement on behalf of Islam was failed at that time. And then came a nationalist, Michael Aflaq from Damascus. He is an Orthodox, Christian Orthodox. He built a party, a nationalist, a socialist, a secular nationalist. The party name was Baath, Mr. Aflaq. This is the first political party in the Middle East. So ba'at is means awakening. He have teach some of the cadres from Arab, from Syria, Hasim Asab, Said Mu'alim from Iraq, Hassan Bakrav, Saddam Hussein, Tuwais Romanin, Tariq Aziz, Ibrahim Hamoudi from Egypt, Zakrahim Muhammad, Muhammad Najib, Jamal Nasir, Anwar Sadat from Libya, Abdul Salam Jalud, and he will later his man, Abel Kadhafi, from Aljazair, from Bin Bella, from Algeria. They have been successful. These nationalists have been successful in expelling the colonials. Then these nationalist countries then emerged, Syria, Iraq, Egypt. Now the country who in the past was the center of Ottoman Empire, they emerged as a nationalist, secular and nationalist due to, because of the bad party. So what does this mean? It's not a religious party. Nationalist is non-religious bad party. The bad party is the non-nationalist. In Indonesia, Kyai Haji Hasyim Asy'ari, the founder of NU, the grandfather of Gus Dur, he was the nationalist, the clerics or Islamic clerics, nationalist. He then at that time in said a quote, who wrote to fight for the country or homeland is part of the belief. Those who are Muslim and embrace Muslim and have practiced Muslim teaching, and but with that they don't fight for their homeland, their belief is incomplete. Or so the Kyai Wahab, his assistant, very close aides of him, he created a song. All my brothers and the nation, let's fight and fight in the colonials, those who come to Indonesia to occupy Indonesia, let's fight till death. Somebody asked me when I gave my lecture in Calcutta, if you love, it's about love to your own country, what, why should it be in Arabic? It's because the Dutch, so the Dutch could not understand it. Because if the Dutch colonial at that time understand, they thought that they speak in Arabic and they just keep praying. But that's why they, yeah, that's the delay. So they made it on purpose because so they want the Dutch. So this the icon of Hasyim Asy'ari and the icon of NU, and that was the modern era of Islamic Nusantara or Islamic of the other Republic. So and if in the past it was there was 9 clerics and in the Middle East there were no clerics, Hubertil Watan Elman, there were no clerics in Middle East that said that loving your homeland is part of your faith. There were no big Hasan Banna, Said Kutub, big scholars in Arab, Usam al-Mintasi, Al-Hudaybi, Yusuf Qardawi, Muhammad Ghazali, Said Sabiq, big scholar Muslim. All of them were not nationalists, not so the non-nationalists are not non-scholars. There were not scholarship in Indonesia. Hasyim Asy'ari was an ulama or scholar who is also a nationalist. In 1926, in 1925, a Saudi Arabian kingdom was established. When Muhammad Al Saud established the Saudi Arabian Kingdom, the four scholar the of the they this they fell to this they reject this kingdom. Then there was this small clerics, small scholars, very low level of scholar. He supported the kingdom. So Al Saud is not Wahhabi. Al Saud is the descendant of Turks, descendant, but Wahhab is At-Tamimi, is the from the Bedouin tribe. He supported the establishment of this kingdom. So these two groups, Saudi will not be strong without Basab or Mahabi schools, or the so they were both supporting. What they do at that time, they destroy all of the previous religion's status, and the house of the where Ali bin Ali Talib, the house of wife of Prophet Muhammad, was changed into a market. The big gate in Arab was then destroyed. Darul Arqam, this is the first Prophet Muhammad gave his teachings, was destroyed. The place where Imam Shafi gave his teaching also destroyed. The tomb of also was destroyed, including the tomb of Siti Istihadiyah, the wife of Prophet Muhammad. Then after they from Mecca, they moved to Medina. The tomb of Prophet Muhammad friends, 15,000 of Muhammad's friends, all were changed or destroyed, but they only left one tomb, that was the tomb of Prophet Muhammad. And at that time, it was they also wanted to destroy the tomb. The Kyai Haji Asim Ashari, when he heard about that, he then established a Hijaz committee, Kyai Haji Wahab, Kyai Haji Zainul Ayrin, as the vice prime minister of Soekarno. He was from North Sumatra, a national hero, and Haji Hajian Gipo, a very affluent rich man from Surabaya. So a very rich people should always also be included. That's a logical thing. He came to Jeddah, and King Abdul Aziz also received, and he congratulated the king. He asked the way of practicing the religious in Medina and Mecca, they provide freedom, so they asked for a rotation, so the so all the schools of Islam have the chance to practice their religion in this city. And also for all of the Ummah, or the people, they can practice their teaching according to their school of thought. And these requests were then rejected. So the Nusantara, the Jawi, so the people from Nusantara, those Negeri Jawi means the Indonesian, the archipelago country, the Islamic. So we ask not to destroy the tomb of Prophet Muhammad. So the two first requests was then rejected, but the last request to keep the tomb of the Prophet Muhammad is what we can see today. When he returned from Kyai Haji Wahab, then returned back to Indonesia and reported to Hajin, so all of the tombs or the historical sites have been destroyed, but they left only the Prophet Muhammad's tomb. All the signs of Islam have been gone in Arab. And then Asim Ashari, he established at the time Nahdlatul Ulama organization on 31st of January 1926. So in principle, tawassut, moderate, tawazun, balance, and tasamu, and tolerance. The idea, the goals were to strengthen the Islamic Brotherhood. Second one, to strengthen the brotherhood of the same nation, citizenship, civility, watana. And also the third one is to strengthen the brotherhood of mankind. These are the goals or the visions of NO. In 1936, NO had the first congress in Banjarmasin, South Kalimantan. What was the first decision? So all of them there wearing a sarong, because the pants was following the Dutch colonial. So sarong, rasong sarong have give you the freedom, internal or external freedom. That's why Indonesian the scholars have a lot of chains, because it's flexible to untie and wear it. So the decision was at the time, the scholars who was not look intellectual or looks different, and they were from the grassroots level. What was the decision? Indonesia Darussalam. Indonesia is Darussalam, not Darul Islam. So these the clerics said that. They were not an intellectual. They didn't have any very high education. They never went to any university. They what we call it, the scholars of a small mosque or something we call that. Indonesia is not Darul Islam or the Islamic country. Indonesia is Darussalam, the peaceful country. Darussalam, peaceful country. Not a Darul Islam or Islamic country. The country that embrace all existing components. It intercultural, inter-tribe, inter-cultures. All of them are our brothers, one nation in one country. This is NU in 1936, 9 years before Indonesian independence. To cut the story short, 17 August 1945, Indonesia gained its independence in August and September, October. They receive the news that Nika or the allied will go back to Indonesia and then to fight for to recapture Indonesia, and at the time to East India. They didn't want to say it Indonesia, they want to East India, and they established a troops what they call Nika. The commander was Malabi general, the general Malabi from British, Bung Hatta, the vice president, the president, and the general Sudirman. They agreed to fight. How to and then they decided who will fight them? The army? No, let's ask the people to fight. Intifada, as you can see in Palestine. In Palestine, people throwing stone, intifada. Basically, being surrounded, or they use all kinds of weapons, using a catapult. I think that's a good. Bung Karno said it's a good idea, but who can give a lot of power? Who will fight them? But who will ask them to fight the people? Hasyim Asy'ari. Hasyim Asy'ari can do that. Then President Soekarno asked one somebody, an envoy, to meet Dr. Asy'ari. I was asked by Dr. Hatta, and then he asked, what is to fight for the country or the homeland? What is? And 22nd October, after he had a deliberation with all the clerics, they decided is Fardhu Ain. It is an obligation to all Muslims to fight for the homeland, even though you are rich or you are noble or low. All of them have to fight, and those who die for fighting the homeland will be have a mat shahid. I'll go to then. So he said that in that Arab, he at that time he used Arabic language. Who is died for their countries, for their homelands, they are shahid. Those who joined the enemy, you can kill him, but he's not kafir or infidels. You know that these days in Indonesia, so they now this day people cut easy to get people are the others, most of them are infidels. So actually, so it's that's Asy'ari is all the infidels converted into Islam. And then Nika came to Indonesia, the Dutch troops came to Indonesia in Mojokerto, Surabaya. So they prepared for Malabi. And the first day of battles, Malabi's car was exploded. He died, his driver died, and the person who put the bomb in the car was not an army, it was the sentry or the scholar of Tabu Irang. His name was Harun. Harun did not escape at that time. He was too close with the bomb. Then there's also another sentry. His name also Ashari. He climbed into the orange. At the moment, you can still see the hotel. The hotel is Majapahit Hotel. He came into climb into the roof of the hotel. He changed the Dutch flag in with Indonesian flag, but then got shot with all of. He was not an army. He was a sentry, a Muslim. So this on the 2nd October, what we call jihad resolution of Hashim Ashari, that is fighting for your homeland, is fardhu ain, or it is obligation for a Muslim to fight for their own country, just like a five times a prayer. Before that, the son of his son, or the father of Gus Dur, also joined as at the Committee of Preparation of Indian Independence. Agus Yamin Muhammad Yamin Wahid Hashim Abi Kusno Laminut Maramis. So these are the committee who made the preparation to Indonesian independence. So Islam Nusantara is archipelago, Islam of archipelago, that combines the culture and religion and culture, not only combine or uniting, but make the culture as the foundation or infrastructure of the religion, not putting the religion first, the foundation, the culture. Homeland will be strengthened first. On top, on the very good strong country, will be built in Islam. So it is difficult, it's impossible to build a very torn country. You can see in Iraq, in Iran, 100% Sunni, they always have a civil war in Iraq, in Iran. In Iraq, more than 1.5 million people died. It is not clear how they kill for each other. They kill each other, it is not clear to whom they are fighting for. The 150,000 people died in Syria. Said Ramadan Al-Buti, who was giving his Quranic teaching, he was killed in Afghanistan, was killed because of the bomb. He was a very good, it is very big call. So Yemen, 150,000 people died. In Libya, in Tripoli, in Benghazi, there's also ISIS or ISIL. They find this Mus'ab Zarqawi. He is a Jordan, but live in Tel Aviv. He was the who built the ISIS. He has a lot of tattoo in his body. He died also. And then Ibrahim Awad al-Badri, he was the member of Al-Qaeda in Mosul, Iraq. He was the representative of Al-Qaeda in Mosul. After Mus'ab Zarqawi died and Osama bin Laden was killed, Al-Qaeda then disappearing. Then Mus'ab al-Badri then came to power in Mosul by America, by the US, by the Europe. They did not do anything to him because they kept him to fight the Iraqis from preventing from fighting the Syria. So they to interfere the Iran, prevent them from helping the Iran, from helping the Assad. But this power is now getting powerful. They rob, they sell cheap oil to the Erdogan son, the son of Turkey president, who always purchase a very cheap oil. This Erdogan. Then there was a lot of overlapping. There was a weapons wound mob. There were a lot of agents, U.S. agents. There were also Jews agents, radicalism, terrorists. So this is a lot of people, a lot of kindness people there. So the Europe and the U.S. also didn't take any action there. after French French was attacked by a terrorist, German was attacked by a terrorist, then they, for the French, when the US started to realize and started to fight ISIS, now they are getting weaker, but they are now keep moving, but this is ISIS. So Indonesia, there are like 1200 Indonesian who fight on behalf of ISIS. They went to there, the son of Abu Jibril, the son of the Bali bombings, that is. So he also, so Bahru Naim, actually Indonesian representative in ISIL, and he is the one who is communicate with their people or their followers in Indonesia. So in this, the reform era in Indonesia, which is very liberal, but sometimes is too over, and with the support of IT and the social media, this is a very dangerous challenge to save Islam Nusantara. We need to keep the harmony, the tolerance, the Islamic people, just like in the past. Now, it is very challenging because why? First, about ideology. When it's about ideology, it is impossible. Abu Bakar Ba'asyir, for example, Umar Patek. Umar Patek is now in the prison. He's Samba Wazir, he is from Pemalang. His father-in-law is Mawaddi. He had a guest station. And Dul Matim Hambali from Cianjur, he's now in prison in Guantanamo in the US. Passport, he had 5 passport. He has 5 nationality: Sudan, South Africa, Indonesia. And from Cirebon, from my hometown, Nasruddin, he bombed the one of the police office in Cirebon. In Kuningan, Cirebon, also he was the one who bombed the Ritz-Carlton Hotel in Jakarta. And then there was also, so all of these terrorists in Indonesia, they were the alumni or alumni of the Pesantren of Muslim Border Skill Boardings in Indonesia. There are 20 boarding school. Asofah in South Jakarta, the director, his name is Oman Abdurrahman. He was imprisoned by after he bombed the Imperium Hotel. And also Al-Faruq in Jumat, Danau Danau Toba, the director's name was Amin Rajab. In Surabaya, Arif Rahman Hakim, the director, Ainul Haris, the boarding school as Al-Fitra. In Bandar Lampung, Olil Albab. In Mataram, Lombok, Umar bin Khattab, and so on and so forth. About 20 Muslim boarding schools of Wahhabi, which all of their alumni, not only they can memorize the Quran, not they can memorize the Islamic teaching, but they know how to make bombs. If NU has, we have 20,000 Muslim boarding school, we have 5 to 6 million santris or students. Not one of them are involved in the terrorists. There are no terrorists NU's students. Why? Because we still control them. They still respect the scholars, the faith of their teachers. We had this demonstration or rally. I was alone. NU was alone. We forbid or asked the people not to go to go to the street, and the people still followed it. If we decided to go on a rally, the Jakarta city will be inundated by the other people. Will be in just from the surrounding country. We asked these people to come to Jakarta to go on a rally. I believe Jakarta. I was asked them not to go to the jamia, and then I was bullied by the people in the social media. How much they pay you, miss? And they bullied me. I know that the risk. I'm fine. I'm fighting alone. So among NU himself, we also felt worried. No, why don't you want to meet Habib Rizieq? Go ahead. You can go yourself. Thank God I can save the Islam Nusantara, Islam, the tolerant Islam. So the only representative of moderate and tolerant representative is Nahdlatul Ulama. Yesterday, just 1 week ago, I was invited to give a lecture in and then when the king of Salman from Saudi Arabia came to Indonesia, I was not in Jakarta, I came to in Egypt. I gave my lecture in Al Azhar University. Why there's a lot of terrorists in Indonesia recently? I thought that Indonesia is Islamic model. Why they still the communists? And I said it comes from you. It's from Middle East. These the terrorists are from, it's not from Indonesian terrorists. They can accept that either. They are not upset about it. So all of these scholars, Muslim scholars in smaller, when they gave their teaching to the people in kampung, what do they say? Peace, be in harmony, work together, help each other, don't fight, stay out of conflicts, remain united. They don't get paid. They are not under a salary. If there are some disasters, like they ask them to be patient. So NU is now the building the countries then the state. NU is building the identity of Indonesian, the identity, the very strong Indonesian, the patient country. And if we have people fighting, we call them and ask them and then to make peace. Husband and wife, if they are fighting. Well, my husband said, my wife is talkative. He never follow my. I will divorce her. He said, don't divorce her. Please, if you don't divorce her, please remarry or marry again. I didn't say that. This so it means that they prioritize or they put the peaceful, the brotherhood aspect. Every Christmas, Ansar or the youth together of NU. They secure these churches. So there was Ansar who also there was a bomb in one of the churches in Istanbul, and this one of this GP Ansar removed the bomb. He thought that one of the Ansar was killed because of he tried to remove one bomb, but he was killed during that. What do you still remember his name? Gipi Ansar. He died protecting the church during the Christmas in 2007. At that time, Abdullah Man Wahid was still the chairman. So until now, when there were rallies on the street, we employed all these Gipi Ansar to the street to protect. So when they had this Friday, they had this Friday prayer. At that time, there were two terrorists who planned to do something during this mass rally of 3 million people in Jakarta. So this is about Islamic Nusantara. If you have any comments or if you have any questions, you're welcome. Apologize. Peace be upon us all.